talk in the Translating Endangered Zones seminar series that I've been organising in our department, which I've tried to make as interdisciplinary as possible, both within the university and outside. At Reading, in our department, we don't have translation studies, but it's something that a lot of us are interested in and that touches on a lot of the research that we're doing. So that was the idea behind the series. It was also an opportunity for our students to learn more about what it's like to work as a translator and interpreter in what we've called danger situations or danger zones. So my talk today is together with Professor Hilary Footitt, who I'm working with on a project called the Listening Zones of NGOs on languages and cultural knowledge and development work. So this is the angle that we'll take, is the languages in post-conflict development working with NGOs. The outline of the presentation is, we thought, because it's such an mixed audience, it would be easiest to start telling you more about how we've come to this project and the kind of research that we've done before. And then we'll talk a bit more about the Listening Zones project, which runs for 3 years, and we're kind of in the middle now, so we don't have that much data yet. But towards the second part of the talk, we'll tell you a bit more about the archival research that we've been doing and the interviews that we've just started with NGO staff. Okay, so my own background. I did my PhD on translation policies at Amnesty International, which I finished in 2014. Amnesty International is a worldwide human rights organization, so it's not a development NGO as we're working on now. But what was very interesting is, and is similar to the organizations we're looking at now, is that it was founded in a British context by a British lawyer called Peter Benenson in the 1960s, and the organization has grown a lot over the years, as you undoubtedly know. It has offices in about 80 countries, and it's active in more than 150. So the rationale behind this PhD, it was in translation studies in that discipline, and within translation studies, there has been a lot of work on intergovernmental organizations like the EU and the UN. The reasons for this are because they're much clearer about their official languages and their take on multilingualism. Whereas there's very little on NGOs, they very often don't make such explicit statements about what their official languages are. And they also often don't have internal translators or interpreters, just a few. They work very often with freelancers, so it's more difficult for researchers to access those people and those institutions. Nevertheless, NGOs are very important political players, and especially for Amnesty as a human rights organization, it puts pressures on governments worldwide on challenging human rights, and it has an international reputation as a neutral human rights expert. So that makes it important to actually know how they translate what they're doing, how they're making their work known around the world. So my PhD was a contribution to translation studies, but it also touched on international relations and organization studies. And I was very much interested in how does it actually translate its discourse. So the focus was quite institutional and not so much on the field. So what did I find? I'll try to summarize the whole 3 years in just a few minutes. That's quite a challenge. So I was very much interested in how do they actually organize their translation work, and how do they make sure that they maximize awareness of human rights abuses and increase visibility of Amnesty. Who translates the texts? Who takes the decisions? How are they funding their work? Is it professionals or is it volunteers that are doing the translations? What languages are they translated in? And how does all of this, the whole institutional context, how does it affect the actual output of the translations and the way that Amnesty's voice is represented? The kind of text that Amnesty translates, these are a few examples of that. So one that comes to mind immediately is their annual report, which is their main publication. But then they publish numerous other research reports throughout the year. And there's other material, like campaigning material, frequency riots, posters, for example, slogans, that's quite an old one, but one that came up in the interviews when translators were talking about their experiences and saying how difficult it can be to translate these nice English slogans into other languages. Take a step to stamp out torture. This kind of wordplay that you have there is very difficult to get across in other languages. Another thing that they translate is urgent actions. So they have about 800 of these a year, so often there are several of these every day, and they're urgent, they need to be translated as soon as possible. So how do they deal with that? What I found is that it varies a lot depending on the language. I also found that Amnesty has been sensitive about languages from its early years onwards, and that its approach to translation grew organically, responding to the organization's needs. So during the 70s and 80s already, they started centralized translation services for French and for Spanish, and later on for Arabic. So all of this was from English into those languages. In the late 1980s, Amnesty for the first time documented its language policy, stating that English, French, Spanish, and Arabic were its official languages, and English was its working language. Later on, the terms they used to refer to these languages changed, and they would start calling them core languages or strategic languages, thus doing away with the impression that they had to translate all of their discourse into these languages, like would be the case with the EU. So Amnesty's take on multilingualism is very much a strategic approach, and it uses language languages that they use, this French, Spanish, and Arabic, are the ones that get priority because they will reach a large audience. This also means that on these languages, they often work with professional translators and in-house staff, a lot of them also freelance, and they work with translation memories and terminology databases, etc. Translation into other languages very often happens on the local level, where local offices decide which documents to translate, who will translate them, and how things are being paid for. So this is also where the volunteers often come in, or the untrained staff. What was particularly interesting about these findings is that the time that I spent at Amnesty, I spent time with them in Madrid in a translation office, in Paris in a translation office, and in Antwerp in the country office, and it was very much a time of change. In the 2000s, Amnesty's approach to language became more institutionalized and its organization changed. And this was linked to its Moving Closer to the Ground campaign, the fact that it was decentralizing some of the tasks and the power that had been focused traditionally in its headquarters in London. Instead, Amnesty was opening hub offices around the world, for example, in Nairobi, Hong Kong, and several other places. Thus being able to respond quicker to things happening on the ground. This also meant that they had new language needs, because text might be produced in other languages than English, for example, and we would have new language pairs. To deal with these new needs, Amnesty founded a language resource center in 2010, which was very shortly before I started my PhD. So I spent some time working with them and helping them also to collect data, because they didn't really know how other local offices were dealing with translation, and there was very much a need to collect this data before they really could start formalizing their translation approach. So where does this take me for our talk today and the project that we're working on now? One of the things that I realized was that the challenges that Amnesty was facing in terms of decentralizing and restructuring were challenges that many other NGOs were facing. My own knowledge and understanding of the NGO sector grew as I read more about the sector in the UK, which I wasn't really that familiar with. For example, in The Guardian has a really good coverage on this in its Global Development Professional Network, and this is an article that they published in there a while ago, and in columns such as The Secret Aid Worker. This article from 2014 talks about changes to the operating field of NGOs due to world changes such as climate change, geopolitical shifts, and also due to funding, because many of them are dependent on government funding and funds were being cut, different ways of funding were being put in place. And there was also increased competitiveness, for example, because South-based NGOs and civil society's organization are now claiming their own space. In answer to this, many NGOs started decentralizing. It's not just Amnesty. The legitimacy of these UK NGOs is being challenged, and donors are asking questions and beneficiaries on whose behalf these organizations claim to act, why and how do they have that power. So to provide an answer or to better defend themselves, organizations such as ActionAid started to decentralize, and ActionAid actually moved its head office in the mid-2000s already to Pretoria in South Africa. Save the Children and Family for Every Child restructured, and they became alliances of families where headquarters in London had much less power than they used to. And this again is where language challenges come in. So I was quite curious to find out how other NGOs were dealing with similar difficulties, and particularly the prominent position of English in the whole NGO field, and why was the use of English often taken for granted. In the case of Amnesty, did the preference for English not clash with the actual values of the NGO and with human rights? And did it not lead to discrimination, for example, in case of job opportunities, if it was a requirement that staff would speak English? So there were a lot of things that came to mind, and one of the things I did, and Hilary actually did as well, a bit earlier than me, was organize a workshop or a roundtable with people from NGOs to sit down and talk through with them the challenges that they were facing. So Hilary organized the workshop together with Intrac that we're working with now, and our colleague Angela Crack at the University of Portsmouth in January 2014, called Do NGOs Need a Language Policy? And I organized one as a kind of dissemination of my PhD and to engage more about translation in particular in June 2015. And it was well attended, with people from these NGOs being present and obviously taking an interest and struggling with these languages questions. For this project, the Listening Zones project, the workshop here at Reading was very important to prepare the funding bit and to better understand the things that NGOs would value in terms of academic research and input from our side, and that's how we got here. So that's how I got here, I should say. Hilary's going to tell the story.
Well, slightly differently. I got here from Warm, actually. I was working on a project with the Imperial War Museum on languages at war. And I think I've taken from that project three things that I've that we've tried to carry forward and look at in looking at NGOs in allegedly non-conflict areas. The first thing I noticed in the work on war was the invisibility of languages in conflict zones. Now you can see this is taken from our case study we did in Bosnia and Herzegovina. You can see the man with the blue berets from the peacekeeping UNPRA board. He's, poor man, is at a traffic barrier here talking to somebody whose language he doesn't speak. And in the middle, you and I can see quite clearly, is the interpreter. Now, we may see that languages are entirely visible. My experience when I began the project on languages at war was that they were entirely visible to the military, on the whole, to war historians, to historians in general, to international development specialists. There's a classic case, I don't know if any of you have seen the film that the lovely Benedict Cumberbatch is in, The Imitation Game, which is about the Bletchley Park Code and Cipher Centre, the intelligence centre in the Second World War, about which an enormous amount has been written. Until we looked at it ourselves, actually, nobody had said that this intelligence operation was in fact a vast translation operation that averaged about 18,000 translations per month in spring of 1944. A huge number of translations, because of course intelligence does not come into us in our own first language, in this case in English. So the first thing that we looked at really in this project, and found surprisingly the same really, was the relative invisibility of languages in NGOs. The second thing I became interested in with the war project was, if you like, the institutional response to the surprise need for languages. How did they cope when they were on the ground? Well, to some extent, they looked at pictorial resources. So this is a pictogram that the British military in Afghanistan used. I mean, the officer that I interviewed said, well, this is all very well, but of course, to use a pictogram, you have to get quite close to somebody head to head. And that was really very difficult in Afghanistan. The other approach that, that the military are still developing is the technical approach. This is the phraselator, which MIT developed, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and they're still developing at the moment, which is kind of, when they used it in Iraq, it's slightly bigger than that. But the idea, obviously, is that the soldier in question presses a button, and then a voice comes out in the correct language, in this case, Arabic, saying, surrender, put your arms up. The problem, of course, is that there's no way that the answer can be easily understood, and that's something that, that clearly the military were not able to crack. So what clearly happened was when the military, and we looked at Second World War, Bosnia-Herzegovina, and as far as we were able to do so in Iraq and Afghanistan, when the military got in on the ground, obviously they had to hire linguists speedily, and there was a kind of a three phase of this, I think. The first was ad hocery, so you basically, in the military, you grab people, literally, who appear to speak English reasonably well. I mean, Bosnia-Herzegovina, those recruited by the peacekeeping force UNPROFOR tended to be high school students who spoke English. Sometimes they studied foreign languages or English in university. Some of them were engineers, some of them were teachers, but basically they were not trained as interpreters. One of them said to us, we kind of learned all this along the way. The second time, in the second phase, the longer the military were there, the clearer it was that they needed local help. They couldn't rely on the local help alone, they needed additional help. They tended to outsource their language provision. So the US military, for example, in Iraq, outsourced to a major company, which largely recruited its linguists from heritage speakers of the languages in the US. And interestingly enough, this produced a different hierarchy of interpreting in the field. So at the top of the interpreting ladder in Iraq and Afghanistan were those relatively few military linguists, officers and soldiers who'd been trained and who could speak the language and who had access to all the security information. And then in the second tier, you had these heritage speakers who were American citizens. So I don't know what their position is today, but at that time they were American citizens and they therefore had access to quite a bit of security cleared material. And at the bottom, you had the local interpreters, who were not allowed to interpret in certain meetings and didn't have access to certain material. So the third phase, I suppose, is basically you do see, certainly in Bosnia-Herzegovina, much less I think in Iraq and Afghanistan, the putting together of a language unit in the end, with somebody who comes in the case of Bosnia-Herzegovina, somebody who set up the NATO language program, who comes in and seeks to organise a translation and language operation the longer the military are in an area. So this sense of how does an institution, whether it's the military or whether it's an NGO, actually deal with languages, what sort of policy does it make and does this change over time, is something that I think we moved into the next project. The third thing I became completely fascinated with really was the role of these locally employed linguists, these language brokers, and really they were cultural brokers as much as they were linguists, because of course the army tends to be on 6 month deployments, a bit like a number of NGOs actually. And so in that situation, they are reliant on the interpreter or the language broker who's going to stay there all the time and he or she has got the book of contacts that the army or the NGO needs. So I began to wonder what was the life of these local interpreters or translators like. The key thing is, of course, that they're local and therefore they are part of the infrastructure. They're embedded in the particular system. They are working with foreigners, but they are part of the local situation. And of course, this produces quite toxic situations in war. I mean, this is quite a famous picture that the Times carried, and then it went syndicated to other places, which is Prince Harry in Afghanistan. And you'll see that he's talking to somebody, and you've got the interpreter in the middle with the face covered, because it's just too dangerous for this person to be spotted as working for the military. The death toll for interpreters, I mean, disgracefully, the military doesn't keep official figures of the death toll of interpreters and translators. So we only have partial figures. It keeps the figures of journalists and soldiers, and to some extent civilians, but not of interpreters. But by 2009, what the work we did suggested that at least 360 interpreters working with the US forces had been killed, more than 1,200 rather injured in a 5-year period. And obviously it's a toxic situation, as we all know from the press, when the army pulls out and these interpreters are left, and the army does not always, or only very late, assume its duty of care and bring the interpreter and their family to a safe haven. There is no official UN protection for interpreters, unlike journalists, for example. And there is a very vivacious lobby organisation for interpreters and translators in war, called Red T, T for translator, which argues that, like ICRC, like the Red Cross, interpreters and translators should have the Red T on them, which means they are protected, they would be neutral, like the Red Cross. And I have some considerable doubts as to whether this would work. And the third thing I wanted to say about the translators and interpreters we worked with was a tendency on the part of the institution, the military in this case, to treat interpreters that they're working with rather as objects or pieces of kit, mm-hmm. a sort of denying their subjectivity. So these, I think Catherine Baker quoted from this last week, didn't she, in her paper? These are some interviews. You know, interpreters saying to us, they said to us things like, don't forget your kit, helmets, body armour, don't forget your satellite, don't forget your interpreter, the lips. Sometimes the interpreters were called yellow cards because they had yellow cards rather than themselves. And then there's this quite long quotation which I will read to you, which is about interpreters being picked up and then deposited somewhere to interpret without any real preparation at all. So I mean, how did this, which is about the invisibility of languages, it's about the institutional response, and it's about the place of the language cultural broker intermediary, how did this play into our thinking on post-conflict development? Well, first of all, I mean, I think the idea, personally, that there's a distinct time of conflict, and then one of post-conflict, you have war, then you have peace, then you have development, is increasingly contested. I mean, I was looking yesterday for my sins at a very large number of applications for grants, and some of them were looking at peacekeeping in Colombia. Now, if you're working in Colombia at the moment, you are working on peacekeeping, but you're working in a situation which is clearly influenced very strongly by the war that's going on, that's still going on in some places. So I'm wondering whether there is a continuum here, I would argue. The NGOs with whom we're working, and Vina will talk a little bit about that in a moment, who are UK-based NGOs, have been used to saying that they're working in a neutral humanitarian space. This expression, humanitarian space, is something that Médecins Sans Frontières, MSF, first coined some time ago, which argues that there's a third space which everybody respects. In fact, I think the pattern is much more that NGOs will find themselves sharing a space with peacekeeping agencies, with particular dangers in regions, that very often you find that humanitarian and development agencies have become marked up, of course, bunkerized. I mean, this is a rather extreme example of this. But I think there's some truth in particular areas that there is a kind of remote working of humanitarian assistance and indeed of development, so at arm's length, obviously in places like Syria, but also in Iraq and Afghanistan, via local groups, via emails, via mobile phones, often without visiting the country at all, using NGO partners very often. So I felt that moving on, for me personally, moving from conflict to so-called post-conflict wasn't a huge step. That may say more about me than about the project. So, I mean, really we wanted to know what happens to these issues of invisibility of language, the response of institutions, the lives and experiences of people who work, both here and in the country, with NGOs. And in this situation, in which NGO, UK-based NGOs, are intervening to help, to provide aid, and claim that their watchwords are listening, hearing, empowering.
I think that brings it together quite nicely. So I came to this project with a much more institutional point of view, and we looked at what the offices are actually doing, whereas Hilary's focus has been much more on what's happening in the field when people come together. But what's essential about this is listening, is central to both of these approaches. So the project focuses on how do international UK-based development NGOs listen to the communities that they want to empower, because that's how they position themselves. That's what we're doing. We're listening to these people. We're giving them voice, the opportunity to speak, and helping them develop. But what is the role of languages and cultural knowledge in this listening? Because very little reference is actually made to languages and to cultural knowledge. For example, in these accountability frameworks that NGOs apply, all the things that they have to do to respond to the donor requirements, language is hardly ever mentioned. But if they're going to these fields, there's a vast number of challenges in terms of languages and cultural knowledge. So how does this actually happen? We've been using the concept of a listening zone in this project, by which we mean not just a space, the spaces of aid, as Hilary has been describing, where the NGO workers actually meet with local communities and beneficiaries. But to us, the listening zone is a much wider space where all of the different actors and factors impacting on the listening come together. So that includes the donors as well. It includes the UK head offices. It includes all country offices around the world, volunteers, NGO staff, and the beneficiaries. So we're interested in all of these factors. The focus specifically is on four British NGOs. You have to start somewhere, so that's the selection that we made. It's on Oxfam GP, Save the Children UK, Christian Aid, and Tear Fund. The choice for these NGOs has been based on a number of reasons. One of them was that we were very keen to do archival research to better understand the roots of these organisations, how they developed over time, and how did they develop their approaches to listening in languages over time. So we have spent the first year of this project doing archival research and reading the archives of Oxfam, Save the Children, Christian Aid, and Tear Fund is a bit more difficult. The second part of this project is to do interviews with NGO practitioners, but also interpreters and translators, both working in the UK and in country. So we've been doing quite a lot of Skype interviews. And the next phase of the project will be to actually go out in the field and do ethnographic observations in three different countries. And these aren't completely established yet, but these will probably be Malawi, Kyrgyzstan, and Peru. And the choice of this is based on the status of English in these three countries and also the period of development that was different for all of them. So in case of English, for example, Kyrgyzstan, English is barely used at all, whereas in Malawi it's an official language, and in Peru it's not official, but you can still use it in some cases. So that's a bit of the background about it. Now, what kind of issues come up when we talk about NGOs? Well, one of the things that keeps coming back is this idea of development speak, the whole jargon that NGOs use and that the sector in general uses. It's very much English, and it comes from a Western background. There's many articles on this, so as you can see, I've been surfing The Guardian again. There's articles on how to speak development jargon, or in the secret aid worker column, buzzwords are killing development, because in the end, it becomes unclear what these terms actually refer to, and how can you transfer those terms into different languages. It's not just a problem of translation, but also the cultural background. If a culture doesn't correspond to our Western worldview, so to speak, it can be very difficult to get those terms across, which I'm sure that some people in the audience can relate to. So this is something that NGO practitioners bring up themselves. This is taken from the feedback forms that we've had from a workshop that we organized recently. So like I said, we spent the first year doing archival research, and then in November, we took some of the material that we had and we organized a workshop at SOAS in London with NGO practitioners presenting some of this material and to discuss with them if development has changed, if the work has changed, have the challenges changed, or are they still similar. And this is, like I said, some of the things that NGO practitioners sent on their feedback forms. So language issues are a blind spot at the head office and in discussions about emergency response teams. The whole idea around language and power relations needs to be discussed in more detail. There's a breadth of issues. translators and accountability and feedback mechanisms. So it has to do with this whole structure of how you actually do development. When we ask the question, you would like to produce a toolkit with this project that is useful for NGOs, they said it needs to go much deeper than a toolkit. If it's a toolkit, no one's going to read it, it's just going to disappear in a drawer. It needs to go much deeper than that. It needs to go deeper than just best practice. There isn't enough research on these aspects. We all have ideas, tools, and policies, but are not really sure how that translates to reality. Very challenging indeed. This is another illustration of the jargon of NGOs. This is a word cloud that shows some of the other terms combined with beneficiary feedback. Participatory evaluation, community monitoring, all of this jargon is very difficult to translate into the other languages, but also to other cultures to convey why you need these things and why you need these feedback mechanisms, etc. This is one of our posters that we presented at the workshop that has quotations from the archives, but we have anonymized all of the material. So we went through this with the NGO practitioners discussing how does language affect the relationships between NGOs and the people and communities with whom they work, and also the dominance of English, for example. Does it influence power relationships on the ground? And some of the things that we found in the archives were this NGO is a multilingual organization with English as a primary language. Can you really be a multilingual organization while saying that? So it's these sorts of issues that keep coming back and back. For example, in program, the local community worker who said, unfortunately today, national languages are reduced in value. Speaking Lingala or Kikongo is proof that you haven't studied or you're not intelligent. Even if there's just one out of a thousand people who speak French, the normal reaction is to speak French. But you don't insist that Americans should speak French. When you're in a church in the USA, if there are one or two French people out of the 50 Christians there who don't speak English. There is very much this idea that African languages, you can see that in government donors and language, that African indigenous languages are ill-adapted to the requirements of modern technological society, for example. Now, these are quotes that I think are from the 1980s, so we're very keen as well to see how things have evolved over time. So we were asking NGO practitioners, how does this resonate with or differ from your own experiences? And what can we learn from all of this for current practice? We have written a draft report on the workshop, which will be online soon. But I can say from my point of view and the interviews that I've just conducted, it's the same kind of issues that come back. So what I'd like to do is read out a few quotations from the recent interviews that I've been doing on Skype with in-country staff. So these are usually country officers or regional managers, so they're on quite a high level. There are a few themes, even though it's at a very early stage of the project, there is a few themes that I've identified up until now that keep coming back. One of them is establishing trust with local communities is a lot easier if you have a common language. So for example, one of the interviewees said, I speak Bahasa as a third language, and when I was in Indonesia, there was a draft response, and we had a colleague from Jakarta, and he spoke Bahasa as well, but you know, normal Bahasa. And then you go out to the community, and they are speaking 15 different types of dialect, and connecting with those people is so challenging. But they understand, you know, they understand that you are trying to speak their language. But even I find it difficult, I mean being a foreigner, they were just happy someone was trying. But they do pick up on your words and then we try to do the same back. And I think breaking those barriers and being able to speak language, I think is hugely important for trust purposes. Because, you know, just trying to understand from their perspective what it is that they value, and I think that breaks barriers that a translator does not necessarily. that's one of them. One of the other things that keeps coming back is that people that work for NGOs that have been in the sector for a long time, or NGO organizations in general, don't value listening enough. Listening goes at the expense of other priorities. For example, one interviewee who's based in Tanzania said, there has been a desire to see more concrete evidence of impact and change and the benefit of aid in the whole. Donors have become more consistent on evidence, have more insisted on accountability. In order to satisfy some of those requirements, project designs have become more complex. The technical vocabulary associated with that work has become more specialized, and English as a language, which does allow the conveyance of that complexity, has been put forward and prioritized. Therefore, national staff who have the capability and are able to use English, you know, to work more efficiently, to write reports coherently and persuasively, these are the skills that more and more are being prioritized. And I think as a consequence, not as a desire, but as a consequence, the fact is that attention to some of the softer skills, some of the capabilities that exist in a more vocal or more oral tradition, are being downplayed or forced out. In each interview, I've been asking about examples of situations where listening was unsuccessful. So this could be, for example, a beneficiary saying, we were not very pleased with this, or we would like you to change that, and nothing happens. So that would be an example of unsuccessful listening. But whenever I ask about listening being not successful, it's about bad interpreting in meetings. And I think many of you will have seen the film Lost in Translation, where you have the scene where there's a Japanese speaker going on and on and on, and the interpreter says one sentence, and that's it. So that's a typical example that I get during these interviews. The last one I wanted to read out to you are two contradicting views on the use and the status of English versus local languages. The first one is a kind of opinion you might expect. The second one was a bit more surprising. So the first interviewee said, I haven't made the effort to learn Kiswahili. When I joined the program here, there were many internal challenges that needed to be addressed and that dominated my attention and my energies, and I did not prioritize taking the time to learn Kiswahili. It is very much to my disadvantage. It doesn't reflect well on me as a development practitioner, for sure. I suspect that this is more and more frequent than used to be the case, as organizations are becoming more professional, as they rely less and less on younger, enthusiastic volunteers. The other opinion was, when I asked, when you move to a different country, do you try to learn the local language? This interviewee said, well, I don't. One of the things is that, this is completely a personal point of view, and you might absolutely disagree with me, but for me, around the world, we are human beings, and we should be able to communicate to each other. And the more languages there are, the more difficult it is to understand a fellow human being. So I'm kind of in favor of one global language that everyone speaks around the world. And that's why somehow I have some internal ideological resistance to learning other languages. So, they laughed. So, but this is just for me, but I deliberately try not to pick up local languages. So if English is working fine, it's working fine. I should add to this that this interviewee was an Urdu mother tongue speaker who also speaks Punjabi, a little Arabic, and obviously English. So it was very different from what I would have expected. So I can only say that I look very much forward to doing more interviews and getting to know more about how people think and feel.
Just briefly to finish with, I wanted to speculate or ruminate a bit on what difficulties and issues there are and will be in doing this kind of research. I'm hesitant to use this as a kind of collective therapy group, but I'd like to share some of these. And you've probably thought of lots more as well, which will depress us even more. But the first thing is about the actors that we're talking to. I mean, who is listening to whom? There are lots of partners with different interests on the ground and radically different contexts for NGO operations. So, for example, we looked at in Malawi, where when Hastings Banda was there, and Oxfam refused to negotiate with Hastings Banda, so they could only have as interlocutors local NGOs whom they actually didn't necessarily trust, or other NGOs. We looked at what was happening in Peru in a very difficult political time, when and NGOs found themselves, they caught themselves being caught between two fires. So on the one hand, there was a government that they didn't trust. On the other hand, there were guerrillas and fighters, and they were in the middle trying to safeguard people. So there's lots of partners with different interests. The organisations themselves, as Nina's made clear, I think, and as many of you will know from experience, are enormously multi-layered, and we're talking really here about quite big UK-based NGOs, and this may not be the same, of course, with other NGOs, but we're interviewing at head office, so we're interviewing people who make policy. Sometimes interviewing somebody who's been director of Save the Children. We're interviewing communications people in the organisation. We're interviewing regional desks, so they have regional desks, but very often based in their UK headquarters. We're also interviewing in-country, so lots of in-country offices. Christian Aid, for example, have an in-country office in Bolivia, which more or less services a large part of Latin America, so we're interviewing them. And we're seeking to interview partners. But of course, we don't necessarily, by doing that, speak to beneficiaries. Indeed, there are some NGOs, like Christian Aid, who do not speak directly to beneficiaries. They always speak via a local partner. And in, you know, if you look at NGOs, as Vina suggested, with the Amnesty experience, they are themselves, very often, these four NGOs that we're looking at, at least three of them, are trying to make sense of this global organisation themselves. So we've already had Christian Aid saying to us, well, you know, we're actually trying at the moment to work out how to globalise and regionalise, so we'd quite like you to come and tell us what you found out from your interview. So it's interesting that they're themselves facing this enormous difficulty. The third actor, of course, that Vina's mentioned, the donors. And in with UK NGOs, this is DFID, this is the Department for International Development, by far and away the biggest institutional donor here. And there we get into the whole business of the politics of evidence that Vina alluded to. You know, they want, we the taxpayer apparently have to have particular sorts of evidence which tends to be quantitative, which tends to be highly extractive, named in our own languages. And so you see, when you look at the history of a great NGO, in my personal view, like Oxfam GB, you see it developing standardised contracts for all the countries in which it's dealing, standardised, because, and they're contracts, so we're going to do this and you're going to do that in return. And of course, the development nexus that Nina's mentioned, which is largely Anglophone and has enormous, you know, as far as I can see, when it's translated into other languages, the Anglophone words remain. They find it very difficult to translate them. And of course, there is the historic view. We have a colleague who's working with us who's looked at the archives of DFID, Department for International Development, and DFID's predecessors in the National Archives. And she discerns a very strong view that English is the language of development. Actually, if you want people to modernise, to move from rural to urban development, then English is the way to enable to do this, and traditional languages are not. So there's an implicit historic, maybe changing, but an implicit historic view that English, monolingualism, for DFID, this is our own Department for International Development, is key to development. And then I suppose in actors, there is what one would have to say, and I don't know if our translator colleagues would agree with me on this, the slight self-protection of NGOs, which is something that I entirely understand. That getting to NGOs is actually quite difficult. I'm really very fortunate in using INTRAC, which is an NGO training organisation in Oxford, and that's been extremely helpful to us. But I think there is, inevitably with NGOs, because of the context in which they're operating, a kind of presentism that they have to spend their time evaluating immediately, short term. Mm-hmm. And this makes it very difficult for them, I think, to have the time, actually, to think, it's not a criticism, it's just an observation, to have the time to think in broader terms, or in the kind of issues that we're looking at. And I think there is, and of course we know it in academic life, with academic bids, there is what one might call the success trajectory, that NGOs don't want to say that they have, that something has been done less well than it could have been done. Exactly what we find when we report on our own academic bids. But it's very difficult to say we didn't do this very well, because it might mean you don't get money next time. And so these are real problems, I think, that NGOs face, you know, in relation, in, as other people do. So that's the actors. In terms of methodology, we were interested to look at listening. I mean, you know, we've got colleagues here from linguistics who might be able to help us here, but our observation is that there's been very little research on listening, really, despite the fact that I'm told that 40% of our waking time is listening as opposed to speaking. The research that we've looked at, and again, I was done to be corrected, tends, and I'm going to be provocative there, tends to be caught up in this post-Enlightenment psychological one-to-one view of listening. And not seeing listening, very influenced by cognitive science, of course, as well, obviously. Not seeing listening as a multi-active, but rather as a one-to-one encounter. But we're seeing it as a field which involves socio-cultural forces, which involves language, which involves physical space, the spatiality of listening. And of course, is temporal. It's more than the one-to-one listening event. It's not just the one event, it's a whole series of events and a whole cultural history of listening. So we've been very influenced by the kind of work from cultural studies by Mary Louise Pratt on the contact zones and hybridity, which has been a lot used in Frankenstein studies.
Yes, lots.
And I found this enormously helpful. I also, Fina's getting a bit tired of this, I've also found it very helpful to look at Ricoeur and this idea of linguistic hospitality, this idea that there's a mutuality in language relations, that I make room for your language as you make room for mine. So that's how we get some sort of equality. I think that interviewing is what we're beginning to find, particularly Vina, who's doing a lot of Skyping, getting languages into the discourse of NGOs that we're dealing with is actually quite difficult. So, I mean, my personal experience, we say, talk about listening, they say, well, I mean, what do you mean, listening? And then you say, well, when you're getting feedback, oh, you've been beneficiary feedback. So there's a kind of, there's getting into the vocabulary without finding that you're actually buying the vocabulary. And so you're trespassing on terms that actually trying to keep some kind of distance, I found personally, from the terms. So, for example, local languages. And if you say, well, what does that mean, really, local? Is French a local language? Or what do you mean by local languages? This is always difficult. The fourth area, I think, in the methodology that's made us think is, I think, about ourselves as researchers. When we've held workshops in our publishing, are we going to publish only in English? I mean, somebody who came to our workshop, two of you actually, you know, said, why isn't this workshop interpreted? Well, there's an answer for that, which is it's very expensive, of course, but you know. But when it's a perfectly valid question, isn't it? Yeah. And why are we thinking we're only going to publish in English? Are we? You know? And who's it going to help? And translating the results, I mean, I was rather cheered by our NGO colleagues when they came to the workshop at CERS in November, saying to us, well, you would be tired of toolkits, don't give us another toolkit. Lots of toolkits. Give us something else, give us some this and that. And I think I'm particularly interested, and this is where our translator colleagues would be so interested, is how you translate these results. And is there, for example, just in translation and interpreting, is there a genre, you know, a profession of NGO translators and interpreters? I mean, I noticed the Institute for Modern Languages is starting a legal translation hub. There's some money to do this, but okay, we're doing it. And I wonder whether translators and interpreters who work largely separately, but probably for the same sort of organisations, whether there's a sense in which, you know, there is a profession of interpreting and translating for NGOs that maybe we should be investigating. Mm. I don't know. Anyway, that's just some of the problems we've got. Thank you.